ओम श्री साई राम, आई ऑफर माई मोस्ट हम्बल प्रणाम्स एट द लोटस फीट ऑफ बिलवड भगवान. डियरेस्ट स्वामी, रेस्पेक्टेड एल्डर्स, डियर ब्रदर्स एंड सिस्टर्स, इट इज़ इंडीड अ वेरी वेरी स्पेशल मोमेंट दैट ऑल ऑफ अस हैव गैदर्ड हियर विथ लव फॉर स्वामी ब्रिमिंग इन आर हार्ट्स, फीलिंग हिज प्रेजेंस इन आर हार्ट्स, प्रेइंग टू हिम इन आर हार्ट्स for inspiration, love and guidance. The theme that we have picked up for this time's conference is who if not we, when if not now. This theme is something very very special because it spurs us from mere theory to move into action. But before going into the theme proper, I would like to make a humble submission in the presence of everyone here, in the presence of Swami who is speaking and Swami who is listening. You know, there was once this time when Bhagwan came walking out to the portico towards the students, and on that day Swami began to ask all the students as to who had spoken in the foyer. There are foyer talks twice or thrice a week in the institute, and the students took great pride in raising their hand and saying, Swami, today I was the speaker, Swami, yesterday he was the speaker, Swami, tomorrow he will be the speaker. And thus the discussion was going on about who is the speaker for the different days. At exactly that time, you know, the practice those days was such that 15 minutes before the bhajans begin, there will be an instrumental interlude. Either the flute or the sitar would play, and there would be music that's going on for 15 minutes, at the end of which bhajans would begin. So at exactly this time, the instrumental music, the flute music began. And Swami asked the boy who had said that he was the speaker, Swami asked, where is this music coming from? And the boy said, Swami, from the speaker. Because, you know, the music was coming from the speaker. And the boy also thought it's very nice when everybody is speaking about speaker, speaker, yesterday's speaker, tomorrow's speaker, today's speaker. The music is also coming from speaker. Swami said, no, where is the music coming from? The boy said, Swami, from the speaker. No, where is the music coming from? That is when the boy realized that the speaker is actually just reproducing the music. The music is not coming from the speaker. The music is coming from the flute of the flute player who was sitting in the bhajan hall. So the student said, Swami, music lopal ninchi. Swami, music is coming from inside, pointing to the bhajan. Swami said, remember, that is the truth always. Everybody is just a speaker. The music, the words, the lyrics, everything comes from inside. And inside is Sai. So It doesn't mean that I am anything special over anybody else. We are all special because we know Swami. We are all the same because our only credentials is that we know Swami. So therefore, as one of my colleagues at Radio Sai puts it, the truth is, it is Swami in me who is speaking. It is Swami in you who is listening. He is the speaker, he is the listener, and let us never ever forget that. On the gravestone of an unknown monk who died somewhere in the 1100 AD, there is this epitaph. An epitaph is the final few words that a person leaves behind so that future generations can look at it and learn from it. The epitaph goes as thus. the monk says, when I was young and I had all the energies in me, I thought I would change the world. But as I grew older, I realized that the world is a very large place. So I thought I would change my country. But as wisdom came, as I grew in experience, I realized that even the country is a very big place. Maybe I can change my city, my village. As years progressed, I began to turn old. I realized that even my village is too big a place. And I thought maybe I can just transform my family. And today, on my deathbed, I realize that if only I had changed myself, maybe as an example, I would have inspired my family. And as a family, we could have inspired the village to transform. Seeing the transformation of the village, maybe the country could have got inspired. And who knows, one day we might have changed the world. Those are the final words of a monk who received wisdom on his deathbed. There is so much wisdom in those words for all of us to learn from. And that is, if we wish to transform the world, if we wish to change the country, if we wish to shape the society, it has to begin from us. It has to begin from us. That is the first part of our theme. Who, if not us? Who will change, who will bring about whatever that we desire that should be brought about, if not us? Because we have no control over the world. We have no control over the country, over the village, over our own family. We have no control over our own husbands, our own wives, our own children. Sadly, we don't have control even over ourselves. So instead of trying to control and change something external, why don't we begin by changing ourselves first? And then with our actions, with our words, possibly we may inspire and transform others. But that is not part of today's story as of now. See, here's one little example. You know, I request all of you to participate with me. Please don't think that I'm crazy. Just for the next 2 minutes, do whatever I am doing. I'm sorry. I will tell you to do some things. Do whatever I am saying. Okay. Do whatever I say. Agreed? Ready? Okay. Here is what I'm saying. Raise your right hand. Your right hand. Now, put it down. Raise your left hand. Good. Now that you have raised your left hand, put the left hand on your head. Now, put the left hand on your chest. And now, put the left hand on your chin. Just look at yourselves. I told, put your left hand on your chin. This is the chin. This is the cheek, right? But why did you put your hand on your cheek when I told you follow what I'm saying? Now, this is a little experiment that shows us that people do not follow what we say. People follow what we do. And that is why it is said, practice before you preach. That is why our actions speak louder than our words. And that is the importance of we transforming ourselves. Because whether people listen to our words or not, people will definitely follow our actions. That's how the whole world is trained. That's how the whole world is tuned. And that is why, that is the second reason why we should change ourselves. Because the first reason, as I said, is that we are in control of only ourselves. We have no control over our family, our village, the country, the world. The second reason is, if we are able to transform ourselves, possibly through our actions, we will be able to make others follow us. Beautiful, right? What further reasoning do we need to understand why we should begin this beautiful process of transformation of the heart with ourselves? Now, you know, one question that may arise is that, see, you told us to follow your actions. You told us to follow whatever you say. And, you know, we are all united. We are all bonded with this love for Swami. And that is why we did what you said. Normally, if you were standing on the street and just doing this or this or this, nobody would have followed, right? Correct? So, there is no guarantee that if I do good, if I do noble things, people will follow me. There is no guarantee about that. So, is there any use? Back home in India, you know, we have several problems with corruption. The current government is trying its level best to battle corruption. But corruption is a harsh reality that we face. And, you know, being students of Swami's institute, our institute, where human values are prized the most, we are taught to be honest, to be truthful, to not indulge in corruption. But you know what happens when we try to follow this? When we try to follow it, we see that by not doing these things, we seem to suffer. Actually, it is not changing the society at all. If I refuse to pay a bribe, I am just missing out on an opportunity to get whatever service I was wanting. Just because I didn't take a bribe doesn't stop bribery in India. It goes on. I'm sure in your respective countries too, you would have faced the same problem. Where it is not as if I become good, everyone around will become good. So the question comes, what is the use of me alone transforming? See, the theme is, if who if not we? Okay, fine, we will transform. But what is the use? Correct? There should be some use. Then only we will do. Then only we will put in the effort. That's what we feel. And it always looks like a few individuals changing. Do not change the world. It doesn't seem to matter to the world at all. Someone may say, look, Swami, what has happened? Swami came, Swami was there on the earth for 85 odd years, nearly 86 years. But the world is still the same. There is still greed, there is still hatred, there is still fighting. So what did Swami do? I mean, Swami himself couldn't change the world, how can I change the world? Dear brothers and sisters, on the face of it, it looks like Swami didn't change the world. But hasn't Swami changed your world and my world? You know, I get tears in my eyes when I think of it. Swami has definitely changed my world. My whole world has changed because of Swami. The way I view the world has changed because of Swami. See, there was this man who was walking on the beach. And the ocean wave would bring starfishes and deposit them on the beach, on the sands. And these starfishes are struggling on the sand. And this man would go pick up the starfish and throw it back into the sea. He throws back, but each other wave that comes brings in more starfishes and throws them over the sands. So somebody else who was walking there told this man, why are you doing this foolish thing? How will it change anything? Because every time you throw a starfish, a next wave comes and deposits so many starfishes. What difference will it make? This was the question that was asked. And then that man doesn't say anything. He bends down, picks another starfish, throws it into the sea, and then tells, it made a world of a difference to that starfish. I may not be making any difference to the world, but I can make a world of a difference to the people and persons who come in my ambit. That is what Swami has done. On the face of it, it looks like the wars are still going on, the world is still shattered. But the person who has been touched by Swami's love, his or her world has changed completely. Don't you agree? That is what has happened to me also. That is what even the Buddha did. Buddha set out to find solutions to the problems of life. What are the problems? Old age, death, sickness. Now tell me, was the Buddha successful? All of you will say that Buddha is successful. I am asking, how can you call him successful? Because did he stop disease in the world? Did he stop sickness in the world? Did he prevent death in the world? He failed in all the three objectives for which he started out his journey. Then how do you call Buddha a success story? You know, Buddha is a success story. And we call him a success story because he might have not changed the external world, but he changed his world. He was at peace. He got peace. He solved his problem of old age, death, and sickness. And once he solved his problem, whether other people got enlightenment or not, whoever came in Buddha's presence were touched by him. Lord Jesus, he had the solution to life's problems. And the solution didn't lie in changing the world outside. You see, in that sense, if you see, people say Jesus is all powerful. And yet, he was nailed on the cross. Couldn't he have the power to stop that? You see, when we speak about power, it's not only external power. The external power is only a manifestation of the internal power. Lord Jesus knew the secret. He knows the secret, and therefore, his world is beautiful. He is not affected. And though the people around him may not have realized this truth, just being in the presence of Jesus was enough for them to experience peace. That is what has happened with us. None of us, possibly very few among us, are realized souls. And yet all of us have benefited by being in Bhagwan's presence. And his presence is not just the physical presence. It is the omnipresence that we feel even today. Because, dear brothers and sisters, as we sit here and contemplate about Swami, don't we feel peace in our hearts? Don't we feel his love? That is the beauty. It is forever. One individual can make so much of a change. So let us not think, what is the use of us transforming ourselves when it is not going to affect the world in any manner? It might not affect the world in a manner that we are expecting and we are seeing with these physical eyes. But nothing goes waste. I'm reminded of a movie that I had seen, you know, a wartime movie. I think the name of the movie is Force 10 from Navarone. This movie is set in the World War II times. Basically, it's about a group of British or American soldiers, I don't remember now. They are given a mission of going and destroying a bridge that is being used by the enemies, that is the Germans, to carry their supplies. When they go there, they realize that the bridge is very heavily guarded and there is no way that they can go and destroy the bridge. That is when they come up with a plan that a little on top of a mountain there is a dam holding a lot of water. The dam is not so well guarded. So they feel if we destroy this dam, then the water will come down in full force and the force of the water will break the bridge. So with that plan, they changed their idea of directly destroying the bridge to destroying the dam, and they moved to the dam. Now when they reached the dam, they realized that this dam is a very, very, very powerful structure, very strong. And you can't break this with the little explosives that they have got. So what do we do? There is a person called Miller, and he is the bombs expert, and he says, don't worry. He takes and places the bombs at different spots on the dam, and then they go away. And when they detonate the bombs, instead of the whole dam falling down, you know what happens? A few holes come in the dam and water starts coming. That water is possibly enough if you want to irrigate your crops or supply some drinking water. It is not enough to break the dam. The explosive is not enough. So everybody turns to this bomb expert and they say, what have you done? What have you done? We have failed. He says, have patience. Just wait. Just wait. As they wait, as a few hours pass, the water starts coming through the hole. The water starts breaking, 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 breaking. And after a few hours, in front of their eyes, they see the whole dam crumbling. And the dam crumbles, the water comes and destroys the bridge. That is the end of the movie. That is the end of the movie, but that is the beginning of an inspiration in our hearts. I just felt that this is what Swami is also doing on earth. This is what Swami has done, In order to wipe out evil and badness, it is not enough, it is not necessary that you have to break the whole dam. Just make little holes over here through which water can come. What is that water? That is the water of goodness. Transform an individual here, one individual there, one individual here. One from Poland, one from Russia, one from India. Transform. Make them channels of goodness. Just like those holes in the dam through which water flowed, these people become channels through which goodness flows. And as goodness flows over time, the goodness has its own impact. It will bring down the walls, it will crumble it down, and the objective will be achieved. That is the inspiration we have to take. The reverse also holds good, If even one of us become channels for badness to flow through, it is possible that we can infect society. That is why Swami would often say, one rotten apple will spoil the other apples, so remove it out. In the same way, one channel of goodness can achieve a lot. Let us never ever underestimate the strength of a single individual. Each one of us are very powerful. Why are we powerful? We are powerful because we are the embodiments of love. Who said? Our dear Swami said. Swami always would call us Prema Swarupulara, embodiments of love. In spite of how much ever anger we had, in spite of how much ever hatred we would express, Swami always called us embodiments of love, because that is the truth. He always saw us as embodiments of love. I just now gave you the example of the dam. A similar kind of question was asked by a student to Swami in Trai Vrindavan. The student said, he asked Swami, Swami, you are telling that you want to, you will transform the world with students. But Swami, how many students pass out of the university? Every year maybe 100, that's all. Swami, there are so many people in the world. How can just a few students bring about a change? You know what Swami gave as an answer? Of course, I will reveal that, but before that, let me put a disclaimer here. When I say student, it does not mean a person who has studied in the Sri Sathya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. Swami had once told that also. He said, being a student of the university doesn't make you a Sai student. A Sai student is a student of Sai. So all of us have the opportunity to be a Sai student. It is just that those of us who possibly study in the university have a bonus of opportunities to become a Sai student faster. But just because we joined the Satsai University doesn't make us Sai students. We become Sai students only when we follow what Sai has said. Only when Sai is our teacher can we be a student. Okay, so that is a Sai student. I thought it is better that we lay that definition clear for all of us to understand, so that I don't grow a horn thinking that I'm special, I'm a Sai student. No, if I follow Swami, if you follow Swami, all of us are Sai students. If I don't follow what Swami has said, even though I wear white dress, even though I studied in Swami's university, I am not a Sai student. So this boy had asked Swami, Swami, what is the use? There are so few numbers of us. How can we transform the world? Swami told him, you ensure that you follow whatever you have learned from Sai. Follow Sai's teachings diligently and perfectly. That's all is your duty. It is my duty to ensure that people around you, in the society around you, will observe you, will get inspired by you, and will transform themselves using you as an example. So you see, if any one of us wants to truly become Swami's student, the headache or the burden of inspiring other people and transforming them is not on us. We just have to follow Swami's teachings and we just have to live our lives according to how Swami has said. It is His responsibility, Swami's responsibility, to inspire others in whatever way they need. Our focus should be ourselves. Rather than finding, you know, Swami had once said in a discourse, if you want to criticize somebody, criticize yourself. Don't criticize somebody else. Because there is no use of criticizing others. If you criticize yourself, you can find your weaknesses, improve upon them, and become strong. That is another interpretation of the statement, who if not us? Whom else do we criticize if not ourselves? Let us perfect ourselves. When we perfect ourselves, everything around will look perfect. That is another example that Swami had told, you know, from the Mahabharata. There is Yudhishthira, the eldest among the Pandavas, the good brothers, and there is Duryodhana, the eldest among the Kauravas, the bad brothers. Both of them were told to do a particular task. Yudhishthira, the eldest among the Pandava brothers, was told by Krishna, go and find one bad person in this world. And Duryodhana, the eldest among the Kaurava or the bad brothers, was told by Krishna, go and find one good person in this world. Duryodhana comes back and he says, Lord, there is not even a single good person in this whole world. Everybody is bad. If at all there is a good person, possibly it is me. That's all. And you know what Yudhishthira says? Yudhishthira comes back and tells Krishna, Lord, in this whole world, there is not even one bad person. Everybody is so good. Everybody has goodness. If at all there is a bad person, it's possibly me. The world outside is a reflection of the world inside. And that is why we have to transform ourselves. Who, if not ourselves? Individual transformation is the most important. Individual transformation will lead to family transformation, will lead to societal transformation, will lead to country transformation, will lead to world transformation. That is the only way. That is the only route. And now, if we are ready for transformation, the next question that comes, when do we begin? That is the second half of our theme today. When, if not now? Now is the moment. Let me, you know, continue to tell about the same brother Yudhishthira, whom I mentioned, he was also called Dharmaraja, Dharmaja, the epitome of Dharma. So Yudhishthira and Dharmaja are different names of the same person. Now this Dharmaja was a person of a very large heart, and when he was ruling over his kingdom, one day he was busy in some act when a person came and sought charity from him. So he told the person, look, I'm busy today, why don't you come tomorrow, I will give you this charity. The person was happy and he went away. Immediately Dharmaja's younger brother Bhima, he went and announced in the kingdom that we are going to have a grand celebration, a feast. This is a moment of great rejoicing. Yudhishthira was puzzled. He goes to Bhima and he asks, Bhima, why have you announced a celebration? Why are we celebrating? What's so great? What has happened? Bhima says, brother, you have conquered death. Isn't that a great enough reason for celebration? Yudhishthira says, where have I conquered death? Bhima then says, brother, you are sure that you will live till tomorrow. You told that person, you come tomorrow, I will do charity. You are so sure that you will live till tomorrow. That means you have conquered death till tomorrow. None of us are sure till how long we will live. That is when Yudhishthira or Dharmaja realizes the wisdom of what his younger brother is saying. We don't know what will happen in the next moment. We don't know what will happen in the next hour. Life is so uncertain. The only time we can be sure of is now. Past is past. We can't do anything about it. Future is uncertain. We don't know. That's why Swami says, past is history. Future is a mystery. Present is a gift. That's why it's called present. And then Swami says, it's not ordinary present. It's omnipresent. It's the omnipresent. Omnipresent meaning the presence of the Lord. And therefore, that straight away answers our question. When, if not now? Yes, we have to do whatever we have to do. And when do we start doing? Right now. Right now is a good moment. Start right away. Be it Namasmarana, be it Sadhana, be it Seva, be it Bhakti, whatever. Start right away. Don't waste even one moment. Time waste is life waste, Swami says. So therefore, when, if not now? I would also like to draw your attention to the point that Swami said, that Swami says, that the present is not ordinary present, it's the omnipresent. See, on one occasion in Thrai Vrindavan, when Swami came walking out, Thrai Vrindavan is Bhagwan's residence at Whitefield in Bangalore. And the students would get the opportunity to interact with Swami in his residence. Swami would call and lovingly speak. On one occasion when Swami came, Swami was looking a little, low. He looked a little sad. So everybody was wondering what happened, Swami. Swami came and said, boys, do you believe that Swami is God? Hey, what is Swami saying? Oh, yes, Swami! We all shouted. Yes, Swami, you're God. Swami said, then whatever Swami speaks is the truth, correct? Yes, Swami. Yes, Swami, whatever you speak is the truth. Everybody shouted together, spontaneously, without even checking what the others are speaking. Instantly. Yes, Swami. Swami then said, now a smile was there on his face. And he said, all of you are God. Nobody shouted, yes, Swami. Why? Swami is himself saying, do you believe I am God? Yes. Do you believe whatever I am saying is the truth? Yes. You are all God. we just don't accept it. We just don't believe it. Because believing it means a great responsibility on us. If we believe that we are God, we have to behave and live in a manner befitting God. We have to lead our lives the way Swami led his life. Swami made an example and showed us how we should lead our life. That is the way we will have to lead our life. It's too tough for us. It's easier for us to say, we are humans and behave like humans. But sadly, we don't do even that. We say, we are animals and we behave like animals. That's what we do, right? We say this is natural instinct. In the name of instinct, we do all sorts of rubbish things. That's why in the world today, families have crumbled, relationships have gone. There is hatred, there is jealousy, there is lust, there is anger. All animal instincts. Animals don't have discrimination. They do what they're tuned to do. What their senses and their instinct tells them, they do that. They kill. They lust. Instinctively. But we have got discrimination. But we want to believe we are animals. So we say it happens. It happens. It's natural. It is not natural. It's unnatural. Bhagwan once announced, I'm going to give you a mantra. This mantra will liberate you. And everybody became excited because Swami is giving a mantra. And you know what Swami said the mantra is? The mantra is, tell yourself, I am not animal. I am man. I am not animal. I am man. And Swami said, once you realize that, then tell yourself, I am not man. I am God. I am not man. I am God. I remember when all of us students who were working in the ashram, we gathered at Swami's lotus feet. Swami, in a private interview to all hundred or so of us, he said, let me tell you a great secret. And Swami said, there is this hall of mirrors, full of mirrors, and a dog entered this hall of mirrors. And when it entered this hall of mirrors, it saw around, it saw so many dogs. It thought, oh my God, if I don't show that I'm superior, all these other dogs will try to show them as superior over me. And therefore, the dog looked at the other thousands of dogs, you know, and growled. And when this dog growled, all the thousands of dogs growled back at this dog. Oh, the dog said, see, what I said is correct. It barked. All the thousand dogs barked. Now the dog got angry and it attacked one dog. And when it attacked the dog, what happened? The mirror fell, it broke into thousand pieces and thousand new dogs came and began to growl at this dog now. And Swami said, this is how a dog will behave in the world, which is nothing but a hall of mirrors. How should a man behave? Swami said, a man now entered this hall of mirrors, which is the world. And Swami said, he looked all around and he only smiled. Because he knew that whatever he is seeing is just a reflection of himself. And so he only smiled. And then so sweetly, you know what Swami did? Swami said, and when this man saw a mistake in another person, that is in the mirror, what did the man do? He corrected himself. And it became fine. Swami said, there is nothing wrong in Srishti, nothing wrong in creation. It's all wrong in your drishti, in your vision. You correct your vision, the world becomes perfect. So you see, that's why, who if not ourselves? There's nothing wrong in the world. If we feel something is wrong in the world, that means something is wrong in us. That means that many things we have to correct. And that is why we have to begin with ourselves. Who if not ourselves? See, dear brothers and sisters, whether we believe it or not, when Swami says we are God, that is the truth. It is like gravity, you know. Gravity pulls everything to the earth. There was this person who said, I don't believe in gravity. The scientists may explain to me, my friends may tell me, whoever may tell me, but I won't believe in gravity. A wise man came to him and said, sir, if you don't believe in gravity, please step off from this building. Please. They were on the 10th floor. He said, please step off the building then. He said, no. Why? Because if I step off the building, I'll go crashing down. You see, my dear fellow, gravity doesn't depend on your belief or your faith. Just because you say that you don't believe in gravity doesn't mean that if you step off the building, you'll start flying. You will still come crashing down. Because that is the truth. Truth doesn't depend on our sanction, on our belief. In a similar manner, when Swami says that each and every one is God, that is the truth. Like how gravity is the truth, that is the truth. Whether I believe in it or not, it doesn't matter. That is the truth. You are God, I am God. And so when you say, oh, this day is so bad, it is like God saying this day is bad. It is like God cursing you, you cursing yourself. Because whether you believe it or not, you are God. You know, that is the reason why modern psychiatrists and modern therapists say, have positive thoughts. Because your thoughts are God's thoughts. Whatever you tell good is a blessing from God, because you are God. We are God. All of us are God. That is the journey that we have to undertake and realize. That is what Swami came to teach us. Swami did not come to set up 100 hospitals in 100 countries and different things. Somebody doesn't become divine just by setting up 100 schools. Sadly, in the world, such jokers are doing such things. There are people who are fooling people in the name of Swami and saying that we have set up 40 schools and therefore it is divine. Swami could set up only 5-10 schools. We have set up 40 schools and therefore Swami is divine. Therefore, this is also Swami. You know, there are some trusts in the world that have set up more than 100 schools. So, do the owners of that trust become God? No. God doesn't come to set up schools, hospitals. Those are all side effects. Those are all byproducts. If Swami came to set up schools and hospitals, what was he doing for 60 years in his physical life? He started setting all this up after his 60th birthday. You know, in the grand scale. If he wanted, he could have built 10 super specialty hospitals. He built only 2. There is a reason. Swami comes. What did he do for 60 years? Interacting with each individual on a one-on-one basis. Interacting with you, interacting with me, interacting with everyone. Raising our awareness, raising our spirituality so that we realize that we are God. Isn't that the reason why on the 20th of March, you know, I really felt that as I was sitting there, instead of raising his hand in Abhayasta, you know, Swami raised his hand in salutation. I felt Swami was telling me, all my life I am telling you, you are God, you are God, you are God. But you don't listen. You always see God outside you. You never see God within you. In order to make you believe that you are God, you consider I am God, right? I will also fold my hand to you. That is what I felt that day. That Swami was showing even in his own action that you are all divine. That is what I believe. Everyone is divine. Because not even once Swami addressed us as ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. He called us embodiments of love, embodiments of Atma. That is the only way he addressed us. And that is that journey we have to begin. And we have to begin it right now. Because we don't know when the opportunity of this beautiful human body will be gone. We don't know how many seconds, how many minutes, how many hours we have got to live. Before that is complete, shouldn't we realize this life's objective? I was telling you about King Dharmaraja, right? his great grandson Parikshit, his story is also very inspiring. He got a curse. I will not go into that story now, but he got a curse because of which he came to know that in 7 days he is going to die. You know what he did? When he got to know that he has got only 7 days of his life, automatically his priorities changed. This is what happens. Just imagine if you get to know that you are going to die tomorrow, what will you do today? Will you spend time fighting with somebody? Will you spend time, you know, getting irritated with somebody? Who has time for that? We will automatically do things for which we give top priority. Otherwise, in our day-to-day life, we don't do things which we have top priority for. We keep doing other things only. Death somehow sets our priorities right. When we get to know that we are going to die, if we get to know we have got cancer and we are going to die, automatically we do things that are on top priority for us. That is what Parikshit did. Parikshit gave up everything else and sat listening to the stories and glories of Krishna. That is the reason we have got the Bhagavata Puranam with us today. The Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the Leelas of Lord Krishna, were narrated by sage Shuka to Parikshit. See, Parikshit at least knew that he has got seven more days to live. Dear brothers and sisters, we don't have that assurance. We don't know how long our life is. Every morning when we get up, we have to express our gratitude to Swami for having given us one more day, for having allowed us to wake up from one more sleep. Because the time will come when we will sleep and we will not wake up. And then every moment we should utilize in achieving this ultimate purpose of life. What is this ultimate purpose of life? Every moment of our life we are trying to be happy. We want permanent happiness. But as Swami says, you want permanent happiness, but you are seeking permanent happiness from things which are not permanent. Including Swami's physical frame. It is not permanent. So how can anything which is not permanent give you permanent happiness? And therefore, if you want permanent happiness, you will get it only from that which is permanent, that which we have to discover. And as a clue, as a hint, Swami has given us a beautiful statement. Happiness is union with God. With that as our guiding principle, let us decide that from this moment, because we don't have time to lose, let us embark, let us progress faster on this journey of finding out and realizing our true reality, of discovering the Satya Sai within our own hearts. Because that is where he is the Hridaya Sthayi. He is the Hridaya Nivasi. And these are not my words. These are Swami's words, which we can listen via his hundreds of discourses that are there available for us thanks to Radio Sai. Dear brothers and sisters, I would like to conclude by offering a humble prayer to Swami. Swami, we do not realize how great a good fortune it is that we have got to know you, that we have got the opportunity to experience your love. But Swami, having experienced your love, let our love for you grow stronger every moment, Swami. Because if we love you more and more every moment, automatically that will bring about the necessary transformation, that will bring about the necessary change. And as the theme of this conference goes, any change has to begin from us, has to begin now. Thank you. Jai Sai Ram.